Random House Audio presents Eat It to Beat It, written and read by me, David Zinczenko. Hi, folks. Thanks for dining with us tonight. We've got some delicious specials for you. Our featured pizza comes on a dough built partially from plastic foam, topped with additives made from human hair, duck feathers, and the desiccated abdomens of beetles, and finished with a delicate dusting of silicon dioxide. You know it as sand. And for the kids, we have a yummy selection of ice creams blended with wood shavings and flavored with extract from the anal scent glands of beavers. And as always, your meal comes free with a chef's selection of more than half a dozen chemicals that are only suspected of causing, but let me emphasize, have not yet been 100% proven to cause obesity, hyperactivity, asthma, cancer, and diabetes. Wait, can this all be true? Are we feeding our kids anal scent glands and human hair? Yes, in fact, as well as more than 3,000 natural and artificial chemicals approved by the Food and Drug Administration as preservatives, additives, and artificial and, quote, natural flavorings. Wood chips, beaver anuses, and beetle bellies are natural, so they're among the, quote, natural ingredients you might be enjoying tonight. So if you're wondering why watching your weight has become so challenging, why all the diet foods and the low-carb this and low-fat that aren't making a difference, it might have to do with something more than your willpower. It might have to do with the fact that much of the food we're buying is filled with things that only vaguely qualify as food, and that marketers and manufacturers are using a remarkable array of tricks, tools, and tactics to fool us into buying their products. In fact, as more and more Americans become health conscious, as we spend more time reading labels and looking for whole foods, organic foods, and natural foods, not to mention gluten-free, vegan, non-GMO, unsweetened, low-fat, dairy-free, no high-fructose corn syrup added foods, marketers have become even more savvy at finding ways to force-feed us things that can make us fat without our even knowing. You can follow any diet plan out there, but unless you know exactly what's in your food, no diet is really going to make a difference. Not until you learn how to eat it to beat it. Introduction. Why is our food so weird? As I said, there are more than 3,000 food additives approved by the FDA, and all of them have been proven safe for humans. No, wait, that's not exactly true. Of those 3,000 chemicals, the FDA only has chemicals and, quote, administrative information on about a third of them. On the remaining 2,000, the administration claims to have chemical and toxicological information, including substances considered, quote, generally recognized as safe, or GRAS. And worst of all, they admit that their 3,000 additive list, titled Everything Added to Food in the United States, is only a partial list because manufacturers can add things to food that they themselves deem to be GRAS. Yes, you heard that right. Manufacturers can just tell the FDA that a substance they're using meets the GRAS standards. And that's too bad, because like you, I love junk food. Unlike most healthy eating advocates, I'm not all about forsaking fries and fudgesicles for falafel and fruit salad. But what's happened is that modern food marketers have come along and ruined all our enjoyment. They've taken good old-fashioned bad-for-us food and turned it into crazy, death-ray science fiction food. For example, have you ever wondered what a diet consisting of wood chips actually does to the human body? If you regularly enjoy frozen desserts and shredded cheeses, check the label. It may list an ingredient called cellulose, which is, in fact, shredded wood chips. I want ice cream, chocolate fudge, gooey cookies, crunchy fries, creamy shakes, but I don't want the food industry dumping weird chemicals into them. They're taking all the good, clean fun out of eating bad. And if you don't think all these crazy additives and preservatives are having an impact on your weight, think again. For example, let's say you wanted to make something called an Oreo sundae. What would you do? Get some vanilla ice cream, crush some Oreos, pour some chocolate syrup on it, and presto, a totally indulgent, bad-for-you dessert. a half cup of Edie's vanilla topped with 2 tablespoons of Hershey's chocolate syrup, and a couple of Oreo cookies will cost you 400 calories. Most of it from fat and sugar. But hey, you gotta live, right? But here's where eating bad turns into eating horribly. What happens if you go to a Baskin-Robbins and order their Oreo-layered sundae? Things get a little more evil genius than they do in your own kitchen. The folks at Baskin-Robbins somehow created a science experiment with 79 ingredients, 11 of which are some form of sugar. As a result, you're downing 1,330 calories, more than 3 times what you'd eat if you just made it at home. Just take a look at how catastrophically caloric our restaurant meals have gotten. In a recent study in the Journal of the American Medical Association, researchers looked at 19 chain restaurants studying a typical breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Their findings were pretty stunning. The average restaurant meal contains 1,128 calories, or about 56% of a person's daily calorie intake, 2,269 milligrams of sodium, or 95% of a person's daily recommended intake. In fact, researchers consider 600 milligrams or less a healthy meal, yet only 1% of all chain restaurant meals meet this standard. 58 grams of fat, 89% of what we should eat in a day. And things aren't any better in the supermarket aisles either. In the dessert section, Pepperidge Farm's 3-layer coconut cake boasts 32 ingredients, including propylene glycol, an ingredient in antifreeze. In the chips and dips aisle, Pace Jalapeno and Pepper Jack Dip has 53 ingredients, and salt is listed 6 times. And in the freezer compartment, Tombstone Deep Dish Pepperoni and Cheese Supreme clocks in with 116 ingredients, including L-cysteine, listed 3 times. What's L-cysteine? A dough conditioner derived from natural sources, the most common of which is human hair or poultry feathers. It's also got some partially hydrogenated oils. Those are artery-clogging trans fats. BHT, a component of embalming fluid, and, quote, natural flavor, which can include any number of bizarre organic ingredients, including the aforementioned beaver anus. What makes our food that much more troubling is that there are so many technical terms at play that it's hard for anyone, even the manufacturers themselves, to really know what's in the product. Natural and artificial flavors, for example, are proprietary concoctions that food marketers buy from big chemical companies to add to their food. Meanwhile, ingredient labels are starting to look more and more like Tolstoy novels, reaching such overwhelming length that nobody has time to read them anymore. Nowadays, you'll find products that list things like corn syrup, molasses, dextrose, sucrose, brown rice syrup, and cane invert syrup, all on the same package. Except that every single one of these things can be called by another name, sugar. Same for things like sodium, sodium nitrate, sodium diacetate, sodium phosphate, sodium erythorbate, and other forms can all show up on the same side label, confounding your attempts to cut down on salt. As a result, the average American man now eats, every single day, 2/3 a cup of sugar, 1/2 cup of fats and shortenings, 2 teaspoons of salt, 500 calories more than he burns off. Is it any surprise, then, that we spend nearly $200 a year per person, man, woman, and child, in America on prescription drugs to fight diabetes, high blood pressure, and cholesterol? Do you think there might be a better way? I do. The new nutrition front. Back in 2007, when I wrote the first in a series of Eat This, Not That books, I was on a mission to get restaurants and food manufacturers to start giving us honest, accessible information on how many calories they were serving us and how much fat and sodium as well. Maybe it was my own lifelong struggles with weight that motivated me. As a teenager growing up in a single-parent household, I was left to fend for myself a lot nutritionally. Fast food was my go-to lunch and dinner, and home cooking was anything out of a box, bag, or can. By age 14, I weighed more than 200 pounds. I was such a languid lump of loaming that the high school wrestling coach recruited me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.